Thank you. Good afternoon. Nadine and I welcome each and every one of you to this gathering to remember and celebrate David's life and work. We and many others have been working all winter and spring to put this event together, and we thank you so much for joining us now. It means more than we can say. We also thank all those who have worked on this program, or are in this program, or who have supported us in so many ways throughout the past couple of years. We are all gathered here because David's life and work touched us in important and different ways. Certainly, his life changed mine and affected my path profoundly. I knew it would from the moment I met him, and it took me a while to decide that I was up for the challenge. He was, from the beginning, intensely committed to the life he wanted and was gifted to live. Now, looking back, it has all passed much too quickly. But I am grateful for all the ways that David's life enriched mine, and grateful that his work is still with me and with you, that it can still move and amaze, delight and enrich us. And I am grateful to be here with you this afternoon as we join with love in remembering David and his work.
Thank you all so much for being here. A few words about my dad. My dad taught me everything I know about challenging the status quo, about sticking up for the underdog, about having compassion for others. My dad could conversate comfortably with just about anyone. My Jamaican neighbors in Flatbush, Brooklyn, the many-generation Vermont farmer down the road in Woolcott, my quick-witted Irish mother-in-law. My dad responded to every letter, email, and manuscript sent by admiring fans or aspiring writers, and he accepted practically every invitation to read at schools, libraries, and prisons in Vermont and beyond. My dad loved ideas and conversation. I will always remember him running for the dictionary or encyclopedia when we didn't know the meaning of something or what its origin was. He was always interested in what others thought, but he also loved to be, as he wrote, in the shining moment in the now, fully in his body, be it gardening, swimming, hiking, playing softball, cutting wood, biking, skiing, snowshoeing, dancing, or walking in the city. My dad learned to ride a mountain bike in his 60s and tried until he could make it up the longest, steepest hill to home without stopping. My dad loved to measure and record things. The distance he rode his mountain bike, he'd finish a ride and get in the car to go clock it with the trip meter. The centimeters of rain in his rain gauge, the nutrients in his garden soil. My dad loved to do thoughtful things for people. He sent a huge box full of fall leaves, orange, yellow, and red, to me and my sixth grade nature-deprived students in Manhattan. My dad was the ultimate goofball. He told jokes, bad ones mostly, loved to sing ridiculous songs, and could outdo any 10-year-old at silly games. My dad was the most dedicated, engaged dad anyone could ever ask for. When I was living away, I would call home and my mother would answer the phone. I'd have to wait to say anything of importance until my dad got on the phone too, lest he miss something. I always knew he would do absolutely anything for me, be it donning tights and performing as the grandfather to my Peter in the ballet version of Peter and the Wolf when I was 14, it's true, or helping me through many a transition with a steady ear and loving encouragement, sprinkled with a dose of his pessimistic realism. My dad tried with all his might to give love and security to my adopted brother, Gene, who died 10 years ago. He tried again to give all his love to my daughter. the granddaughter he'd always wanted. Even though she was born just as PSP began to incapacitate him. My dad, more than anyone I've ever known, lived fully with both joy and suffering. He did both with such intensity, integrity, and love. Whenever I asked what my dad wanted for Christmas or his birthday, he always said, peace and justice around the world. I, frustrated, would say, no, what do you really want? His answer was always the same, peace and justice around the world. He said this again to me as he lay dying in a barely audible voice when I asked him if I could get him anything. Peace and justice around the world. That was my dad.
We'd like to invite you now to join us in reading David's poem, All of Us. It's on the first page of your program. And I wonder if I can have the lights come up a little bit. There we go. We'll have better lights, I think, if you can see it. It will be a responsive reading. I'll give you a second to find it, but I think the rustling is slowing down. Out of the undifferentiated Tao come the 10,000 things.
Who has just risen from the chair and walked across the room to look out the window at the bird in the tree with the bug in its mouth.
See how all of us, at our own different speeds, return to the Tao.
Oh, let us all sing praises now, for all of us, so briefly here.
North is nowhere, nihil, emptiness. And Judavine Mountain is north. Come to Judavine Mountain and step into oblivion. Lose yourself in this remote and lonely wilderness. There is no mirror here, no way to tell where you might end, the others begin. Here you are no one, only one with everyone. Come to Judavine Mountain and find out who you are. Come to Judavine Mountain and disappear.
Thank you. Thank you. Remembering David, I first knew David and Lois just shy of 50 years ago. For the academic year 1967-68, we were all teaching together at an African-American college in southern Pennsylvania. It was an edgy part of the country to be in those days. It was Ku Klux Klan territory. The Klan had burned a cross on the campus the year before I got there. And it was an edgy time to be on a black campus. We were there when Martin Luther King was assassinated in Memphis, and one of our students was shot in the back and killed by a policeman while home on Easter break. Of course, a half century of racial progress later, nothing like that could happen now. The tension abroad in the land filtered into the campus, but tended to concentrate in places like faculty meetings rather than on the streets. At one faculty meeting, some of the older professors, more conservative ones, took exception to something that a younger, more activist professor had done or said, something they found too radical or too black for their taste. One by one, they went around the room, heaping abuse upon him, until David stood up. David's message was short and simple. The professor being criticized was making points that deserved to be heard, he said. We should step back and listen with attention and respect. In that moment, something of a small miracle took place, or perhaps a large miracle. The tension and vindictiveness that had been gathering in the room dissipated, and we went on with our meeting in an atmosphere of attention and respect. If you've ever been in a college faculty meeting, you know how implausible it is for a room full of quarrelsome academic egos to suddenly mellow out. But that's what happened. It was a doubly David Budbill moment. Of course, it was David seeing injustice and speaking to it. But I think it was also David's Taoist side coming out as well. David was part Taoist, part Buddhist, part Christian, part whatever else. I see the Taoist part as that lets you enter so fully and so intimately into the flow of a moment that with the merest shrug of a shoulder or choice of a word, you can nudge that moment toward healing. Somehow, David was able to find exactly the right words to pull off his miracle and do that. I said that he did it through a message that was short and simple. That's the way he wrote his poetry as well. In one of my absolute favorites of David's poems, he makes the rather Taoist point that when it comes to language and use of words, less can be more. Here's David's poem. Pare everything down to almost nothing, then cut the rest, and you've got the poem I'm trying to write. David lived out that poem through the end, his disease paring him down little by little to almost nothing, and cutting the rest, leading us to try to find meaning in the silence. Memory naturally spills over into that kind of silence, and my memory of David at that meeting 50 years ago is one of my vivid memories of him. It has obvious relevance for today, a time like the late 1960s, where the nation is divided, angry, and fearful. At a time like this, there's great need for each of us to stay alert to injustice and to speak truth to it when we see it. But not to stop there. More important, and perhaps most difficult of all, is to call forth our Taoist sides, speaking truth into the flow of things in ways that bend toward healing rather than adding to the discord. I find that it helps to remember David doing that.
There are some people who are such a constant presence in your life that it's hard to focus on any one moment. Instead, the interactions all weave into a bigger tapestry of feeling and connection. I've known David my whole life. As a child, I would go to Lois and David's for art lessons, for family parties, to babysit Nadine, even after setting fire to the toaster. But it was as a young adult that visiting David and Lois took on a new significance for me. I would go there and draw on their immense reservoir of support. As a gay teenager, nowhere felt like a sanctuary in the way that, their house did. Over tofu stir fry, I could air my latest discoveries, worries, and obsessions. I counted up Lois for the depth of her empathy and her amazing listening. Thank you. By contrast, David's listening usually involved talking, making connections between his experiences and mine. In finding these connections, he engaged me 100%, treating me as a peer, as someone with something to offer, with an experience he could learn from. Life fascinated David, not just the dramatic events, but the texture of ordinary existence. Everyday details are what make his poetry so compelling. But before you can write it, you have to live it. And the life that David lived was one of studied simplicity. If there was a gadget manufactured to accomplish some task, David would revel in his ability to accomplish the task with duct tape, a knitting needle, and a pair of old overalls. Although there was a certain high-end smoker barbecue that undermines the story I'm trying to tell you. He was an anti-consumer. He liked to wear things out and then keep on using them. He had no use for labor-saving inventions. What this points to is a love of honest work, of work that required skill, craftsmanship, and perseverance.
The home that David and Lois carved out of the forest was a testament to these values. It was a simple yet enchanting place, carefully planned and meticulously executed. The vegetable gardens, the flower beds, fruit trees, bird feeders, wood piles and walking trails, each element contributed to an environment that was calm and harmonious. But what made this place magical was the warmth and humanity that suffused it. And the source of this, of course, was David and Lois themselves. To visit them was to have one's spirit replenished. It was also just plain fun. I don't think I've ever called someone of my parents' generation a buddy, but that's exactly what David was to me. And what an unlikely place to find a buddy, my husband's family friend's dad, but there he was. It was his sense of humor, his quirkiness, his penchant for exaggeration, his warmth, his consideration and empathy, the fact that he chose to live as an artist, these are the things that drew me to him. The first time I met Lois and David, they acted as mediators to a fight that Tom and I had been having. That I felt an immediate sense of trust in Lois and David is incredible, considering I'd only just met them. And our friendship grew from there. David was game for adventures like canoeing down the Tamarack Brook, or simply great company for hours of carefree floating on the pond. On the morning after Nadine and Mia's wedding ceremony, about 15 of us cleaned up from the previous evening's party and then sat down for an informal breakfast together, chatting amicably. David, near the end of this meal, made a very clear declaration to us all sitting there, and he said something like this. As I sit here, surrounded by you all, sharing this meal and good conversation, I feel okay getting old. I can accept that death is coming eventually, knowing what I leave behind. You amazing people.
This is for David Budbill. Gotta set this. I don't want to go over time. David Budbill died 47 days before my mother. I don't like death. wrote about life and death. I idolize David Budbill. I write about death. I say when someone young dies, doing something they like, and you say, but he had a heart attack when he was just 47, it's sad, but he was playing tennis, so he died doing what he loved doing. You're saying that because it makes you feel better. Stop saying that. I hate that. Because if I am doing something I love doing and I die doing it, it's the goddamn last thing I want to do. And someone dies after suffering, you're young, and you say, well, he's not suffering anymore. He's in a better place. He's in a better place. Where's that? Heaven? It's better than earth? Show of hands, people out there who know there's a heaven. You do, sir? Okay, there's a heaven, sir, yes. My dick's a foot and a half long. I only got one ball, and it's the size of an avocado, too, sir. Thank you very much. Inappropriate at a memorial? This is David Budbill's memorial. That ain't inappropriate. Heaven on earth. We got heaven right here, man. We got buttercups. Ferns this year with the rain growing out of ferns. Trees lose a limb, another one grows right out of it. I live 10 more years, how many opportunities does that give me to eat pizza? You go to the store, buy a 25-pound box of Captain Crunch. We're living in heaven right now, ladies and gentlemen. You go to Cumberland Farms, draw yourself a jumbo Coke Slurpee for $1.69. This is heaven right here. You got legal dope, free college, win $1,000 a day lotto for the Democrats and for the Republicans. We got college girls with daddy issues. Son of a bitch, this is heaven, ladies and gentlemen. David, life, fantastical. He loved physical. You loved instrumental? You loved improvisational? And you loved rhythm? He wrote with rhythm. We all know that. See if I could do this. He'd love this. Thank you. He'd love that. I'd like to present a short, unrehearsed interpretation of what I know of David's life from start to last, percussively. This is when they moved to Vermont. Sensitive poetry bullshit right here. Run out of time. The heart beats till it doesn't. You don't get to finish. I want to die doing something I hate. Going to a wedding. Mine. Enjoy it, because this is heaven.
I first became aware of David Budbill as the author of Bones on Black Spruce Mountain, a book my friend's father worked to ban from our high school library. 2 years later, my mother arranged a writing tutorial with David Budbill as my teacher. The first thing David asked was that I learn to type. Type. Wasn't I going to learn to write with a famous author? With David's encouragement, I have it right here, P.S., keep up with your typing. I did learn to type, and I've been grateful ever since. The skills, spirit of inquiry, approach to language, and ideas David introduced to me that fall have been present every day in the 35 years since. David introduced me to academic rigor. I read a book and wrote a paper each week. David corrected and commented on my essays, and I did start to learn to write. Once, and only once, I wrote about something that was very unique. And every time I hear those words together, I remember what I learned from David. He wrote it at the top of one of my papers. Unique means one of a kind. Therefore, nothing can ever be very or rather unique, since those are words of comparison, and no comparison is possible with something that is unique with something else like it, since there is nothing else like it. Once I began to get the mechanics of writing, David urged this. These are his words. Now listen to the rhythm, the cadence of the sentences, and try to get your sentences to flow gracefully. David also guided my approach to the assigned reading. Again, his words, take your time, reread, think, stop, go back. In other words, take it slow while you are reading, and then the writing will be easier. David also challenged me to think, inquire, explore through reading and writing. He wrote, you are confusing Christian teaching / religion with Christian society. There is a huge difference between the two, in my opinion. We'll discuss this. 7 years later, when I opened the Galaxy Bookshop, David became a faithful customer and friend of the store. He said yes to every event request and helped move the store more than once. David's books have influenced how I understand the land and the people around me. Lastly, and enduringly, David was a loving friend, and in celebration of that and all he continues to give us, I offer this poem. I had already turned onto the short road to the lake when I saw them, a man in his truck with his dog looking across the water. On my horse, I did the same. We kept our distance, though we knew each other some. Small town. The man, now so quiet, had once thundered and railed to keep David's books out of the school. I imagine the two men visiting now, decades of living between them. I imagine this man might be lonely, and I think about David suffering his disease, and I want a poem to ease them, to connect them again, to let them know that on a quiet and beautiful night, on a quiet and beautiful horse, I imagine them friends. This big setting sun, this vast lake and sky, bringing them together in peace.
Can you all hear that?
Mm-hmm.
Nature has provided a big downpour for this. And I got to know David through his poetry when Chainsaw Dance came out, which I loved. So I made a point of meeting the poet, even though he lived in the next state. We became friends and correspondents. Many visits and hundreds of letters through the years. When David's last book, Tumbling, toward the end, came out, I noticed that the first line, the first lines of the first poem were these. Stand beside the wood stove, hands on butt, palms turned out, face the window to the east. Well, I recognized the ritual. I had seen him perform it unselfconsciously, often during visits. So I would like to read two of his poems where he praises his wood stove, which he loved. He had a beautiful old wood stove. And when people started building air tights and more advanced technology, I never heard him consider changing from that wood stove. So, ode to our wood stove. Inside this little wooden house, on a Vermont slate hearth, stands our trusty, faithful, large and sturdy cast iron stove, in which, for more than 40 years, I have built from fall to summer, fire after fire to keep us warm. Oh, to get up on a cold winter morning, start the tea water, then make a fire, and while the tea steeps, add some logs to what's already going. Then stand beside the big old stove and feel the warmth radiating out from its cast iron into the room and me while I drink my tea and daydream watching out the window. Oh, round oak stove made by the estate of P.D. Beckwith of Dowagiac, Michigan, more than 100 years ago. Finally, now I sing your praises. I praise your great gift to us over all these years. Ode to fire, ode to heat. Epigraph, a mountain recluse doesn't have many plans. All he talks about is his fire. Half my wintertime life, or so it seems, I spend standing beside our old wood-burning stove, which stands at the center of our house, hands behind my back, resting on my butt, palms out. Warmth of the fire in the wood stove working its way into my body. Then turn around and bake the other side. Too hot? Just move a step or two away. It's so simple, easy, and all you've got to do is work all year. Sweat and heave and groan to make this little moment happen. Now I praise primordial fire. I praise heat in its most basic form, this blessed warmth that comes from our old wood-burning round oak stove. Now I sing the praises of a wood fire, of the heat this smoky burning liberates, till this dry heat that keeps us warm all winter, even when it's 35 below.
Dawn. Summer morning, and I'm fishing on the river in Perot's pool, which is just upstream from Singing Bridge, the bridge with iron grating on which your tires sing. I call this place Perot's pool because it is a deep, still stretch of water with overhanging trees and the hand-laid stone abutments of an old bridge on either side. And on a sunny morning, the light through the trees falls upon the water and makes a dappled quietude of irresistible tranquility. It is the kind of place where Corot would be if he were here instead of me. For as long as we have been here, people have fished here, walked here, watched here. I cast a lure into the water, then watch the sky more than the river. I hear the cry of an osprey out to find her breakfast. But I neither hunt nor work. Instead, I climb out of the river, sit down on the quarried stone of an abutment, pour a cup of coffee from my thermos, and relax for what was already relaxation. And I think.
No matter who lives, who dies,
the seasons never rest. Creatures take their turns.
And the year turns.
And turns.
And turns.
In spite of all that could be wrong, it is. In spite of all the pain.
Summer and winter.
And summer and winter.
And summer again.
All is change. There is no constancy.
The farmers on the hills and in the bottomlands.
What farmers there are left.
Are already doing chores.
In the village, everything is quiet, but soon.
Conrad will pad 100 feet from home. Unlock the garage. Turn out the light in the window that says beer. Put on the coffee pot. Turn on the gas pumps and the air compressor. And then stare out the window at the empty early morning road.
Soon also, just across the railroad tracks and over the meadow from here, Roy McInnes, mug of coffee in his hand, will move from house to shop, swing open the doors of doors, and begin the day.
Alice and her lover will roll over under the covers and embrace each other. And Laura Kate, both retired in their separate houses, will rise, prepare their separate breakfasts, and go about the things they do to get ready for another day.
And there are those who live their lives alone.
Lucy, Carol, Conrad,
and then Grace. Those who left.
Arnie went down to Massachusetts.
Bobby and Doug lost the farm and got divorced.
Lucy finally got sent to Waterbury.
Ah, and Jerry, good old boy Jerry. Remember Jerry? He dumped his middle-aged wife and ran off to New Jersey with a 22-year-old girl.
I could see that coming a mile away.
And I remember Antoine dancing in the house of his body and saying,
"Ah, baby, what would we do without each other?"
And I remember the ghosts.
Raymond.
Tommy. No matter who lives, who dies.
The seasons never rest.
Creatures take their turns.
And the year turns.
And turns. All change.
Midnight. Outside the car is 15 below. A foot of new snow.
The village is deserted.
Except for 8 street lamps and the light in the window at Jerry's garage that says,
"Beer."
The smell of wood smoke seeps into the car. Judah Bonnie.
Ugliest town in northern Vermont.
Except maybe East Judah Bonnie.
Disheveled, wretched Judah Bonnie.
Judah Bonnie. Is beautiful in the night. It is beautiful because its couple hundred souls have given up their fear, their poverty and worry. And for a few hours now, they know only the oblivion of sleep. And the town lies quiet in their ease.
Thank you.
we got to make a campfire and have a cookout on the lawn. We got to eat some chicken and light our fire and drink some wine and watch the night sky.
Suffering world, we must also